August 9th, year 2001. We're in Stony Point, New York, and the camera operator is Mr. Charles Safara, and the interviewer is yours truly, Sal Arrico. Today, or this afternoon, we have the privilege of being able to interview Mr. Edward Kwiecinski. Mr. Kwiecinski, matter of fact, will be celebrating a birthday tomorrow, and he was born on August the 10th, 1918. I understand that Mr. Kwiecinski was born locally. Is that correct? Where were you born?
Right down on the brickyards, the waterfront of Haverstraw.
The waterfront of Haverstraw. Were the brickyards in operation then?
They were still operating. There were four or five yards that were conducting their business.
Now, 1918, that's just around the time in which, well, you were in the middle of the Depression pretty soon after that.
That was before the Depression.
Yeah, but after.
World War II had just ended. World War I had just
ended. Okay. How were things at home at that point?
Well, they were hectic. All I remember is a lot of kids running around all the time.
Okay. And then, of course, the Depression set in.
Depression set in, right.
How was it at home? How did you and your family were affected by the Depression?
Well, we had very little of anything, I would say. No electricity. No radio, no telephones.
So obviously you didn't even have a phone at the time, but that was not on account of the Depression, it's just the way that Haverstraw was, is that
it was. We had no bathroom, we had outhouses.
Uh-huh.
And we carried our water from outside, actually.
What did you do for traveling if you had to go somewhere?
Walk.
Walk, huh?
That was it. We were too poor to own a bicycle. And nobody had automobiles at that time.
Right.
Well, no four people.
Right, right. Was there a lot of use of horses and buggies at that time?
It was all horses.
All horses and buggies, huh?
All horses and buggies.
Okay. Now, how old were you when you were involved in the service? First of all, where did you go to high school? Where was your school?
Haverstraw High School.
Haverstraw High School.
First I went to West Haverstraw Grammar School. Then I went to Haverstraw High School, but I was a dropout. I didn't complete. I got my equivalency diploma later on. But in 1935, I joined the CCC camp.
Uh-huh. How was it?
Civilian Conservation Corps. Well, it was great. Yeah.
What were you involved with in the CCC camp?
First, we were involved in building a dam at Bear Mountain for lake water conservation. Then later, I was transferred to Salamanca, New York. And we were involved in road building. That was it.
That puts you in the late 30s at this point, just about.
That right? Was in the middle 30s.
Middle 30s.
Middle 30s.
And soon after that, things started brewing in Europe.
Right, right. We started coming up war clouds.
Right. What were your feelings at that point? How old were you?
Four.
Approximately.
18, 20.
Okay. What were your feelings then? Pertaining to what was happening in Europe?
Well, right.
Was there there any apprehension or?
No, it was just world events taking place, and you took it as it came.
Okay. Obviously, then of course, the war broke out, and you were involved with it.
Right.
Were you drafted or did you volunteer?
Well, I actually volunteered, but I was going to be drafted anyway, so it made no difference.
Okay.
But I was going to be drafted in a few months.
What was your feelings at the time, and the feelings of your parents? Of you going into the service, really?
Well, everybody was going into the service. I mean, it was the thing of the day.
Now, when you went into the service, you went into the Army, is that correct?
Right.
Where did you take your training, your basic training?
First we went down to New York City, had a physical in order to get into the Army. After the physical, then we put in the Army, we were sworn in. I was shipped to Fort Dix, New Jersey, equipped with uniforms and basic training, and then I was shipped down to Fort Bragg, North Carolina, to the Artillery Center.
Is that where your service took place, in the artillery unit?
Artillery, strictly artillery.
What was the unit's designation? Well, that wasn't the unit that you went overseas
no,
with.
No, by no means. That was just training.
Oh, okay.
That was just basic training.
Okay.
But Fort Bragg, we were assigned to a permanent fighting unit. After Fort Bragg, I was assigned to the 28th Division. At first, I was assigned to the 107th Field Artillery at, which was later broken in half, streamlined, and the 2nd Battalion was made into the 229th Field Artillery Battalion, which I served. And I served with that unit throughout the whole war.
Okay. Let me ask you a question, Ed, if I can call you Ed, if you don't mind.
Certainly, certainly. No problem.
Let me ask you a question. One of the things that is really engraved in our minds from the beginning of training is your serial number. Your serial number and your rifle, those are two things you never leave behind or forget. Do you still recall your serial number?
I sure do.
What is it?
320-85725.
Okay.
Now the rifle number is another thing.
Okay, right.
I forgot that.
Now you went, you were in the States, up to this point you were in the States, in training and what have you. What happened after that?
Well, we were shipped overseas.
Directly to where?
England.
To England. Okay. And then from England, what happened?
From England, we stayed over there for the winter, we went over the fall, and we stayed till the invasion.
You're talking about the Normandy invasion, of course, right?
Exactly.
Were you, when you shipped over out of England, were you part of the invasion force, or did you come in after the...
No, we were backup.
You were backup at the time?
The 29th Division.
Okay.
The 29th Division initially landed.
Now, when you went from England, where did you go from there?
We left England from Wales, England, across the channel. Overnight, we landed at Omaha Beach, and one of the divisions was already established.
happened at that point? Was there still any, obviously, was there still any fighting at that point?
Not us.
Not for you at Omaha Beach itself?
Oh, they were fighting at the beach.
But when you arrived, had the fighting already cleared?
It was sort of quiet.
What, where did you go after that? Where did you end up going, you know, after you established?
After Normandy, we broke out of Normandy. I think it was the latter part of July. We broke out of and took it across northern France.
Do you remember any of the towns, any names?
Owen,
what?
Percy.
Right, but you went through part of France, really, in the process.
The whole north of France, yeah.
Okay. Where did you go after that?
Well, we went to Paris.
Okay.
We participated in the celebration, the liberation of Paris. From there, we went almost on a direct line to Belgium, Luxembourg, Germany.
Okay. Well, I'll come back to that. But let me just back up a little bit and tell me a little bit about the celebration during the liberation of Paris. How was it? What do you recall of it? What were your feelings?
My feelings? It was just an everyday duty.
Did you participate in the actual celebration at all?
No.
In the march or anything like that?
In the march, going through it, yes. But in the celebration of it, no, we weren't allowed.
You weren't allowed to celebrate?
No.
Huh?
But no way, we were on duty.
Okay. Let me ask you a question at this point also. One of the things that you usually do not forget when you're in the service is Army Chow.
Army Chow.
How was it? Well, did you have any or didn't you have any?
It was good, bad, and indifferent.
Okay.
When we were in garrison, and the food was available through the depot, it was fun. There was no complaints. It was pretty good.
How about in the field? What did you have?
In the field is a different story.
What did you have in the field?
Anything we could hold up. We usually had K rations.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't have four. They would issue us C rations. They were in the camp with C rations. And then we had what they call a 10-in-1 ration. It was rations in a package capable of feeding 10 people.
Did you trade with other people?
All the time.
All the time, huh?
Yeah.
How about interaction with any of the locals, as far as, food during the war? It was very, very scarce. Now here you had something.
We were discouraged from eating good food.
Were you able to give them anything at all?
Very little. Everything was rationed out.
You didn't have much yourself, right?
Well, I had enough.
Okay. Now you've moved through out of Paris, and you're going through Luxembourg, part of Belgium. What happened there?
Slow us down, like the screaming meanies would come over.
What were the screaming meanies? So that some of you may not know what they are.
Screaming meanies. these were artillery shells, I guess, that they had not too much destructive value, but a lot of noise and weird sounds that would, you know, try to throw you off balance, I guess.
Now, in Belgium, I understand that you were involved in a particular historical situation.
Well, that came later.
That came later. Okay.
Yeah, but before we went to Germany, we went to Luxembourg, and there was a pocket of resistance north of Luxembourg. They called the Hurricane Force. We went up there. We spent about 3 weeks trying to dislodge them up there. No success.
No success at all.
No. So we pulled back down into Luxembourg. At the tri-corners of Luxembourg, Germany, and Belgium. There was supposed to be a rest of it, but the Ardennes battle took place.
Some rest area.
Known as the Battle of the Bulge.
So you were right in the middle of the Battle of the Bulge.
Exactly, right in the middle of it.
Tell me something about it. What do you recall?
Well, I recall one thing. I don't know if it was the second or third night that we were involved there. There was a Corps general that came around trying to size up the situation. And we were digging in for the night. He was asking all kind of questions. We were giving all kind of different answers that he didn't like. So we told him we couldn't tell him anything. Well, we didn't know anything. And he turned around and said, "That's good," he says. "You don't know anything," he says. "I found something."
You remember,
recall
that, right? Okay. There was some, to put it very mildly, very heavy fighting in the Battle of the Bulge. But do you recall any particular acts of heroism or
everything was normal. There was no acts of heroism. But what we did, we had to do, and that was all there was to it.
Now,
there were times we were going down this road, and we had to turn around and come back the other way.
Even in very dire situations, usually sometimes trying to get away from it, in our minds anyway, we may resort to some humor. Do you recall of any humorous situations or instances then?
At the moment, no.
No. Okay. Do you recall any acts of bravery on anybody's part?
We did what we had to do, and that's all.
And that was it.
Okay.
I mean,
we was never up to hand-to-hand combat.
Right.
You know?
How about making friends during that period of time? Did you make many friends, or? What were your feelings on making friends?
Yeah, we had close friends and pals. And there was other guys that we would talk to.
Okay.
Yeah, they're good and bad.
That's right. One of the most pleasant parts when you're in the service, times I would say, is when mail call rolls around.
Oh, we look forward to it. whale would catch up to us.
It would catch up.
Eventually, it would catch up to us.
How far in the back was the male really when it caught up to you? Approximately.
Oh, I don't know. Anywhere from a week to, say, a month.
Did you have any problems in, if you had time to write, in writing and sending it out?
No. If you had the time, I mean, you'd write a letter most anywhere.
You know the old saying in the Army, hurry up and wait. And you do an awful lot of waiting sometimes. How did you pass the time away? What did you guys do? During the waiting period?
Convince.
Okay.
Yeah, there was always a few clowns around that would stir things up or somebody's... There was always somebody that was doing something.
Do you recall at all, not that you walked around with a record player or anything like that, but do you recall at all any of the songs or the titles of the songs of the period that you guys were interested in? Or?
No, I guess we were interested in any of them or all of them that you can hear.
Were you fortunate enough at any time to have any entertainment come out and see you at all? Or?
Very little.
Was the USO coming out at all, or groups like that?
We used to read about it in the Stars and Stripes.
Yeah.
That was the Army newspaper.
How often did the Stars and Stripes come out? Or when did you get it? How often did you get it?
We got it now and then.
Now and then.
Sometimes it would come out regularly. Other times you don't compete without it.
What did it tell you? What was the format? What was it?
It just had little bits of information. Nothing in detail.
Did they give you information about back home? Or? How things are.
Oh, no.
None of that. This had to do strictly with what?
Yeah, it was strictly military.
Did you, were you awarded any commendations at all, or ribbons, or were you wounded at all?
Not personally. No.
Your unit did, though, right?
No, my unit, yeah. We got units, citations. We got the belt across the gear. And we got a presidential citation. But that was a unit citation, not a person.
Were you wounded or?
No, I was never wounded.
What happened after that?
The first night I remember in combat, this happened to Norman. We were bivouacked right near heavy steel artillery battery. And that night, the Germans came over and made us invisible bombs. We lost a man by the name of Jim Sable that night, and I guess 4 or 5 were wounded. That was our initiation of the battle.
Obviously, you remember the person. Were you very friendly with him?
Oh, yes, very friendly with him.
Where did he come from?
He came from Pennsylvania. Pittsburgh.
Were you involved in any other close call situations, let's say?
Well, we had a lot of close
you
calls.
Did, you did have a lot.
But they were close calls. That's the reason I'm here. They were close calls.
If you had an opportunity, let me back up now. We're up at the Battle of the Bulge.
Right.
Okay, that's where we left off.
Yeah.
What happened after that? Where did you go?
What after that?
Yeah, what were you involved in that? What occurred?
Well, we after Bastogne, I was in Bastogne on the 22nd, I think, 23rd of December. And then we left there. We went up around towards St. Vit, if I can call it. Then from St. Vit, we went to Spa, Belgium. The Germans were chasing us all around the place. Our fort got siege, one pointed in a different direction.
So you were really surrounded at that point, just about.
Mm-hmm. More or less.
Yeah. Right.
But usually there was always a unit that would come around and open up a road. So we get out of the situation.
Where did you end up going, or where did you go after that?
After the Battle of the Bulge, we were supposed to reorganize our unit. We were sent down south of Nancy, Colmar, France. And we wound up there helping the 1st French Army get out of a predicament they were in. They had a pocket of resistance out of Colmar. We went down there.
Did you have, what was the interreaction between the American Army and the French Army? Was there any give and take?
Nah, everybody ignored him, I guess. The French Army, they more or less kept to themselves, and we kept to ourselves.
What happened after that? Where did you go after that?
After that, we went back up around Pittsburgh, Germany, Kaiserslautern, Heidelberg. Up there, and then it was time to cross the Rhine. And soon after that, the war. War ended up in May.
I believe it was, yeah. So you did get to cross the Rhine?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah.
What occurred after that?
After that,
what happened? Well, they didn't leave you there.
Huh?
They didn't leave you there. What happened?
Well, what happened was they had to transport troops from Europe. They had to go to the Pacific. They had
a little one, right?
Yeah. So they had what they called the point system.
Okay.
People that stayed were in the army for a long time and seen the most action, they would take them out of the army and send them home.
But they received a certain number of points and they could go home?
They received a certain number of points to go home.
What was the magic number?
The magic number was 85. If you had 85 points, you were slated for redeployment. If there was transportation available.
Oh, okay. There isn't.
There was a catch to it. All right? 85 points. Yeah, I had 125 points.
Yeah.
I had more points that I could have gave mine away. So everybody else. Plenty of points.
Did they have
so I was left behind and served at the Army of Occupation.
In Germany itself?
In Germany itself.
Right.
And all we did was, you know, flounder around and have a good time.
Good. And what happened after that?
We came home.
You came home. How did you get home? What was the transportation available? You went from Germany back to where? Straight home or England?
No. We come right straight home. We came from Germany. We went by convoy from Germany. I think was Le Havre. We bypassed Paris this time. They took us right to the seaport, put us on the SS America. They shipped us home.
Uh-huh.
And I came in on Newport News,
Virginia. When you shipped out from the United States, you shipped out of where?
Boston. Yeah. They had shanks right down the road.
Right.
I've never seen it.
Okay.
I went to Boston to come in down to Virginia.
Obviously, the family must have been very happy when you got back.
Well,
not to mention
while I was in the RBO, I had some bad times. I lost my father. I lost my mother. I lost my brother.
Were you notified of it at the time?
Oh, yeah. But that's just it.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
That was all we did to notify.
Let me ask you one question, and that is, if you had an opportunity, and you do have an opportunity now, to talk to your great-great-grandchildren, what would you like to say?
Jeez, that's a tough question. Try to do the right thing.
After the war ended, and you came home, you've been under strict military atmosphere all this time. Now you had to adjust to civilian life.
No problem.
Did you? Okay, you beat me to it. No problem at all.
No problem. I have no problem.
Now, how was it coming back as opposed to when you left, living conditions? Was it any better or was it bad? Or?
I would say about the same.
Ed, my name is Charlie Sapara. How you doing today?
Okay.
There's a couple of questions I'd like to ask you, since you've been so kind enough to give us the time. You said earlier when you were going through Luxembourg, you chased the Germans up to a point and you were fighting with them, and then there was so much resistance that you left them there. Why did you leave them there? Was this part of the action when Patton was there, that he was bypassing all the major resistance?
No, Patton was to the south of us. He was on our left flank.
Okay.
And we were on the northern flank, and just on the left flank were the British.
That was Montgomery's group.
Montgomery's group. Right.
Which general did you have? Which group was the general of your group?
We fought under all the generals, but Bradley, I think, was in command of the time.
Okay. So what he preferred to do, rather than fight him, bypass him, and then pick him up as prisoners later on, is that correct?
Well, that's part of it, yeah.
Did you pick up many prisoners along the way? Did you see many?
Not at that time. Later on, we picked up a lot of prisoners.
But that's later on in the war when you went into Germany.
In the war, yeah, but at this particular time, no.
You said you were in Bastogne. Were you there for the total battle of the
No, don't misconstrue me. I was in Bastogne, I say, prior to the encirclement.
Oh, okay.
I was in there because we had to go in there. There was an ammunition dump just on the outskirts of Bastogne. You had to go in there and get ammunition. And we just beat the Germans.
What type of ammunition?
Artillery shells.
Oh, artillery shells.
Yeah.
But they couldn't have
been... That's what we were firing, artillery shells.
Okay,
105.
The Germans couldn't use them, they just
No, right? They would just capture it, but we couldn't use them either if they captured it.
Yeah, right, that's for sure. Were you part of the liberation of Bastogne?
No. Definitely not.
When you said you crossed the Rhine, wasn't that the start of Germany? The Rhine River?
Yeah, the Rhine River runs on the western part of Germany.
What was the major river, or if you remember, that the Russians met the American troops during that war?
I couldn't tell you. It wasn't the Rhine.
It wasn't the Rhine, though, right?
No, definitely not.
You mentioned that your brother, you lost your mother and father in World War II, at home, obviously. You also lost a brother. Was he at home, or was he part of the fighting forces?
He was in the fighting forces. He was in France. He fought with the 8th Infantry Division, which was battling the Germans on the southwestern part of France, where they had submarine bases.
You said he was attached to the glider corps?
Yeah. He took his initial training as a glider infantryman.
Was that over here in Ellenville, or where was that taking glider training?
Glider, he took it out in Nebraska.
Nebraska,
yeah. Where they had a lot of farmlands, a lot of fields. Practice their glider, I guess.
Yeah, that's an interesting avocation in the Army, coming in with gliders. I don't know if I could do it. How about you?
I don't know if I could do it either.
So when did, approximately when during his time in Europe did he get hit?
It was in the, I would say, the middle part of August, around this time.
August of 44.
August of 44, yeah.
Did they say what area? No.
They gave no specifications.
Just that
he was killed in action.
Did he receive the Purple Heart posthumously?
Yes, I have that.
You have it with you?
Yes, I have that.
Here's my show on this.
Okay.
Hey, you're kind enough to go upstairs and pick up the Purple Heart that your brother received. You zero in on it, so the sentiments can stay. article that was written at the time. Can you hold that up? This was in a local paper in 1944, is that correct?
Right.
Let's see if I can zero in closer. That should give your descendants a good picture of what your brother was like. And you have a picture of your brother also, don't you?
Right.
You want to hold, let me see if I can zero in on that. Which one is your brother?
The one on the right.
Oh, the one on the right. Oh, okay.
And that's me on the left.
Let's get a picture of him. Let's get it. Okay, there we go. So that's your brother John.
Right.
And you're down on the left.
Right.
Who's the older, you or your brother?
I am. By 2 years.
2 years.
He's 2 years younger than me.
Who are you holding? Who are you holding that? Who's that picture you're holding?
He's the nephew.
And his name?
His name is Albert. Albert Frank.
Albert Frank Kwiecinski.
No, Albert Frank.
Oh, Albert Frank, I'm sorry.
No, he wasn't a Kwiecinski.
I'll tell you, this is very interesting to get a picture of your brother, yourself, and one of your nephews. And I hope your nephews will get a shot and he'll see himself being held at that particular point in time. That's interesting.
Good. He's, 60 years old, I guess.
Sure.
He's as old as I am.
he's 60 years old.
He's got a. Is he live locally in the
area? No, he lives up at the Saratoga Springs.
You're gonna have to. When we give you the CD, you're gonna have to send him a shot of it.
Anything else you guys want to say?
One of the things that Ed did while he was in the service was he kept a personal diary of all the places that he went to and their dates. This is just, the writing is very small. And I'll turn the page over and the old dates.
Is that the one? No, that's not.
That's not the one. No.
That's the one.
I know Ed on here even has the name of the ship in which he shipped out, the dates, the training,
yep.
Every place that he went.
Ed, this Camp Pickett, Virginia, 7/30/1943, is that where you reported in, or was that where you left?
No. That was one of the training camps.
So this isn't a chronological diary from the start.
This is just partial.
Okay, so we see you've gone Virginia, Massachusetts, down to Nova Scotia in 1943. You landed in Ireland in 1943. Okay.
Yeah, Bristol.
Okay, where did you leave in, let's see.
I think it was Bristol in where we landed.
You landed on the continent and let's see, in Omaha Beach, July 22nd, 1944.
Now you got it.
Okay, from there, here's the St. Louis Police. I can't pronounce some of those names.
I can't either. I feel good.
And that's through August. And then we're into.
Yeah, the end of August, we went to Paris. Beginning of September, secret, sir. Division with the help of the 2nd Armored and the 707 tank destroyers.
What were the tank destroyers?
They were fighting boys, huh?
What were the tank destroyers?
Tank destroyers, boy, they were tank destroyers.
What they consist of, Ed?
They had mobile artillery.
How large?
105s. Same as us.
You use a 105 on a tank?
Yep.
On the Tigers?
They run like on half tracks. Not on tanks. They were tank destroyers. They were mounted on the track vehicles.
Like a caterpillar.
Right.
I heard that the Tiger tanks during World War II were really tough.
Well, I don't know about that.
With these tank destroyers, right?
Right. These tank destroyers, they were great. I'm telling you.
It helped 105, 105 shell.
About that. 30 inches.
How round?
Oh, a little over 3 inches. 3 inches, what, about like that?
Okay.
Something like that.
And these would pierce a Tiger tank with no problem.
Well, it all depends on what kind of warhead you use.
What type did you have?
We had all different types.
What types did you use on the tank?
Armor piercing.
Was this the type that would pierce the armor and explode on the inside?
No, that would just pierce. Yeah, well, they would all explode.
It was only a matter of when, correct?
Right. Yeah, but the armor pierced, they had all different types.
Well, I'm looking at the last page of your exploits in Europe. What's that? Langeler, Omaha Beach, November 1744. What happened there, Ed? How'd you end up back in Omaha Beach?
After the battle of Hurricane Flores, we were shipped down to Luxembourg for a rest and recuperation period. It was to rebuild our units that were depleted. And while there, I was detailed to go back as part of a detail to pick up our duffel bags, which we had left on Omaha Beach when we broke out in July. Our duffel bags with our gear, our clothes and all. So we went back to pick up our belongings.
Were you still in summer gear at that time, or were you going back for your winter gear?
Yeah, we were still putting our same summer gear, yeah. Yeah,
it got a little chilly in November, didn't it?
Yeah, well, it was cold. Never mind chilly. Yeah.
When you were on R&R, how long a period of time was that?
Pardon?
You said you were going for R&R. How long a period of time?
Long time.
Because you were at the front now. You're at the front for almost 5 months,
five,
4 months,
five,
4 months.
Right. We didn't change our clothes too often, I'll tell you that.
But living conditions were kind of sparse, really, wouldn't you say?
Yeah, we take our baths out of our helmet, and now we take sponge baths, that's about it. We do that on the helmet.
By November, you sure weren't jumping in the streams anymore.
No. Well, that's the reason we went back to pick up our duffel bag, because that's where our gear was, our clothing. And that was for the whole battalion.
You said you were going back, you also looking for replacements. How much casualties did your
output take? Roughly.
Oh, I don't know. I couldn't tell you on the
10-20%.
But there's always casualties. I'd say about 20%. When you're speaking of casualties, guys just get sick as a casualty. If he can't perform his duty, he's a casualty. I mean, he don't have to be killed or wounded, you know, to be a casualty.
Well, let me finish off the book where you were, and get back to Omaha Beach here. Let's see, that was November. And let's see, it ends at Rockenhausen?
Rockenhausen.
On April 23rd in 45. What's that last army of occupation from April? The war ended in April 23rd?
Well, it ended for me.
How did it end for you?
We were taken out of the line.
And you say you were on the army of occupation.
Well, what we were doing, I mean, the army, they were still battling. But we were taken out of the battle line and given the job of occupation.
Is that where you started to pick up a lot of the prisoners that you were talking about earlier?
Well, that was part of it. That was part of it, yeah. And you had to control the civilian population. You had to tell them what the rules and regulations were then. Not before, but then.
Did the civilians give you any problems?
No problem, God.
Were they happy to have you and get rid of the crowds, or what was the story?
They were mixed. They were mixed.
So you had some partisans amongst
the group? Oh, yeah. Oh, definitely. Yeah. There's always diehards.
Did you run into any resistance at that point?
No. Nothing to speak of. No, they were very cooperative.
They
had no choice, though, but to be cooperative.
Okay.
You had a gun sticking in your ribs, you'd be cooperative too.
And what's that book you hold in your hand?
The book of the 28th Infantry Division. It's history and the battle accomplishments of World War II.
You have a particular page marked. What was that marked for?
That particular page, the book is marked Our Parade Through Paris.
That picture looked very familiar. Isn't that the one that was on most of the...
It was on national syndication at the time.
No TV at that time.
No TV.
I would say, was that Channel 7 News? Hold on, wait a minute, I want to get that date on that, Ed. That's when you moved into Paris on August 29th, 44, correct?
Right. All right. And you left on the 30th.
Well, you didn't stay long.
Nope. We parked. We bivouacked in the park overnight, paraded, and we were on our way. We lost no time.
And here I thought Paris was a party town.
Couldn't prove it by me.
What's on the next succeeding page, Ed?
That's...
There's some of the local...
Mademoiselles. I'm sure they had a good time, too.
Good shot you got. Is that your group coming marching there? Is that your outfit, Ed?
No, not yet.
What's that arch that's in the background? That's
Arch of Triumph.
Arch of Triumph. French put that up for which war?
I'm not sure now. Which war?
one they were trying.
That's it.
1870? .229 field artillery. I happen to be right, right behind it.
Who are those people? Yeah, anybody recognize?
No.
That book is really, really records everything you've done pretty much, or your output has done. And I have a question I want to ask you in closing.
Yes? Look through that to see if you want any more, then.
You've experienced a real costly war in World War II. The world lost many millions of people. I believe it's recorded approximately 70 million people. You've seen some of the horrors of war. You've inflicted some of the horrors of war. Regarding war, your descendants, what would you tell them regarding war? If they were experiencing a situation that you experienced, what would you advise them to do?
Try to resolve it.
Without war.
Without war, naturally, yeah. War benefits nobody.
When you came out after the war, did you have the GI Bill?
I think that was passed a little later. Initially, no, there was nothing. I think that was just a mustering out type. I think we got, what, $300 or something. It wasn't much.
Well,
and
then
the GI Bill came later.
I must say, it's been a pleasure. You've enlightened Sal and I, and I'm sure that any of your descendants, when they go down to the Library of Congress pull up this videotape, the CD, you're going to be highly enlightened and you'll feel proud. Thank you.
I hope so.
Thank you very much, Ed.
Ed, I already closed the conversation with you after, and you tell me you've got all these medals. And I says, how could you leave out the medals in a videotape for your descendants? Here, you're showing us a picture when you were younger. What are some of the things that you're alongside? I see your dog tags are there. Can you point them out?
Yeah, this is my initial dog tag, and this is my replacement dog tag.
Okay, what's the difference between the replacement? Why'd you get a replacement?
Information.
What's that red rope going around?
Red rope is the Belgium Cross de Guerre. Belgium.
What did you get that red rope for?
From the Belgium Cross de Guerre.
The battle of which one?
Battle of the Bulge.
And those hash marks, what do they represent?
They represent overseas service. Service on foreign land. Each bar represents 6 months.
The bottom row of medals.
The bottom row. One is the conspicuous New York State Medal.
Ed, I see what you're holding there is a diploma from the French government for the liberation of Normandy. And alongside of that, I see your military service record for your battalion.
Right.
And the group of people you went overseas with.
Right.
Thank you very much.